So today is Easter Sunday. It's supposed to be a day that ushers in a time where we come together and we spend several weeks celebrating the resurrection. But several weeks ago, something happened and it changed all of this. Now, early on, we actually thought that we would be through with socially isolating at this point, and we were going to focus on preparing for Easter Sunday. We actually thought we would be back to our normal gatherings by now, but we're not, and therefore we're all experiencing Easter at home. Now, while this is all different, it actually probably resembles more of what that first Easter Sunday was like. You see, our Easter is typically filled with like bright colors and lights and exciting songs, and rightly so, because it's a celebration. But the first Easter morning actually started in darkness. There wasn't a grand celebration. There's no Easter egg hunts, although I'm pretty sure everyone had Reese's peanut butter eggs in their icebox that morning. But we'll maybe need to check the facts. But my point is, the mood was probably more similar to our mood. Moments filled with sadness and moments of grief, maybe even moments of gratitude for what once was, filled with moments of fear and regret. You see, on that first Easter morning, the disciples still actually had no clue about the resurrection. See, the Sabbath was over, and some of the women in Jesus' inner circle were preparing to go to the tomb where his body lay so they could prepare the body for a proper burial. Everyone was in the beginning stages of grief as a result of the crucifixion and the things that Jesus went through. In fact, Mark tells us that they were mourning and weeping. And in fact, most would not even become aware of the resurrection until that night. Now, on the first Easter, the disciples were actually hiding in fear from the religious and political authorities. In fact, John 20:19 tells us that they were hiding behind locked doors for fear of the Jews. Now, we can imagine what it was like to be in the midst of this dark cloud, hiding with their own thoughts and feelings about what had just happened. Hiding with their memories about the time that they had spent with Jesus over the past couple of years, and even how they walked away from him. When they had spent so much time walking with him, eating with him, and learning from him. Then they all ran when he was arrested. So, really, that first Easter Sunday was mainly dark and filled with all the feels that come with these life-altering events. In fact, the gospel accounts give us some insight into what that time was like. All four gospel accounts actually mention something about this time period between the crucifixion and the resurrection. And Matthew 28 tells us that after the Sabbath, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Joseph, went to the tomb, and it was still dark. They showed up to the tomb, and an angel was sitting on the top of the stone that had been used to cover the entrance. And then the angel tells them, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead." And Matthew goes on to tell us that they ran to tell to the disciples. And Matthew describes them as being filled with fear and great joy. Mark tells us that they were afraid, for trembling and astonishment had seized them. So here's the thing. When Mary Magdalene reached the disciples, they heard that he was alive and had been seen by her, but they would not believe it. Luke says that these words seemed to them as idle tale, and they did not believe. But Peter rose and ran to the tomb, and stooping and looking in, he saw the linen cloths by themselves, and he went home marveling or wondering at what had happened. We're also told that John ran with Peter to the tomb as well, and that he also saw the body of Jesus was gone. However, they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. So both Peter and John go home wondering what in the world just happened. So on top of all the other feels that they were experiencing, they have this added bewilderment concerning the body of Jesus and what could have happened to it. Now, did you catch all of the words used to describe what they were feeling? Things like mourning and weeping, fear and joy. trembling, which is actually a word used to describe anxiety. Astonishment, which is another word for bewilderment, or literally displacement of the mind. In other words, it's the idea of not knowing what to do with or process the information that you're receiving, or maybe some experience that you just went through. There was wondering and disbelief. And I think that all these are words that can describe what we have gone through over the past couple of weeks. All these contribute to this overarching ambient tension we feel in the background of life right now. And they actually were on a bit of a roller coaster, kind of like we are. Sometimes we feel sad. There might be a sense of grief, or maybe even a feeling of gratitude in the next moment. This social isolation is like torture for so many. There's so many things you no longer have to look forward to in your day-to-day. Some of life's major events have been altered or canceled, like weddings and graduations and church gatherings. And there are these feelings of loss and bewilderment. This is more like what the majority of that first Easter Sunday was like. But then something happened later that evening. Luke 24:36, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace to you." But they were startled and frightened and thought they saw a spirit. And he said to them, "Why are you troubled, and why do doubts arise in your hearts? See my hands and my feet? That it is I myself. Touch me and see. For a spirit does not have flesh and bones as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. And while they still disbelieved for joy and were marveling, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" In other words, in that moment, they were so overcome with all the feels that come with amazement and bewilderment that they couldn't wrap their minds around what they were experiencing. And so Jesus is going to help them wrap their minds around the fact that he was literally with them. And so he says, "Give me some food and I'll show you." So they gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it before them. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." And then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. So you see, that first Easter did not begin with some grand celebration, but it ended with the resurrected Jesus showing up to his disciples who were hiding in fear and grieving and mourning. Disciples who were filled with anxieties and fears and disbeliefs at the literal absence of the presence of Jesus. They're shocked and amazed as Jesus once again appears. So while we are absent from one another, our usual gathering spaces have been literally emptied. Remember, the church still remains the church, whether gathered or scattered, whether in large buildings or in our homes, whether face-to-face or social distancing, the church is still the church, and this time does truly function as a symbol of our trust in God's ability to meet us regardless of where we are. So just as on that first Easter Sunday, Jesus showed up in their hiding and in their social distancing, he met them with their fears and confusion. He met them in the middle of their grieving, their loss, in the middle of their shock. And he also meets us here too. Yes, it looks different. It even feels different. But I think it should, because this is your faith and your trust on display in these moments. What you truly depend on, lean on, is being revealed. So let this time be a reminder that those disciples who were hiding on the first Sunday morning, that eventually led a movement that would overturn an empire, which spread hope and love to all people, they were able to do this because the power that was behind them was the same power that raised Jesus from the dead, and it's the same power that lives within us. And so out of this darkness and chaos, out of our fears and anxieties, out of our grieving and bewilderment, we celebrate Easter. We celebrate Easter because it has the power to turn the darkness into light and to bring us comfort in our chaos. And today, we celebrate Easter, whether gathered or scattered. For he is risen. He is risen indeed.
Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, you silence fear. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, breathe, call these bones to live, call these lungs to sing once again. I will pray.